Welcome back to the Sunrise Safari. Sorry about that. It seems as though the internet gremlins has jumped aboard Djuma, so they won't be joining us for the rest of the show. You have now got the Taylor and Jamie show. Woo! And the crowd goes wild and everyone is so excited now. And I'm only joking. So we're still sitting with our lionesses. They've perched up on a termite mound. You won't believe what happened. As we were sitting here, obviously all the animals now know that the lions are here. Thank goodness the baboons have just stopped alarming. Everyone's starting to settle down. And two unsuspecting warthogs came running past and the lions sat down. They had no idea they were up on the mound and maybe only 10 to 15 meters away. And they didn't do anything. I couldn't believe that they didn't charge after them and try to grab them. So they're obviously not as hungry as we thought they were. And now that the day is getting warmer and warmer, the clouds are starting to thin out. I wonder where they're going to go and find a spot to rest, because up on that termite mound is not going to be a very nice, shady, cool spot, as you can imagine. But they're still awake, they're alert, they're looking around. I just don't think that they're going to go charging after anything right this second. I got so excited when those pigs came past. But now they're gone. There's lots of animals around. The Topi police are still watching the lions very closely. There's a warthog just walking below the Topi as well. Yes, you stay behind the Topi. That's your first defense right there. And the water buck and everything else, well, they don't seem to be too bothered. They're just keeping an eye out at the moment. I don't think those water buck down there, or even that, I wonder if that warthog knows that there's lions moving around in this area. There was, like I said to you a little while ago, there was a huge group of warthogs. There must have been about 20 or 30 of them, all just coming out of a network of burrows. So it's a good area for them to live around. And like we know, at this time of the year, the diet of the lions tends to change from that of wildebeest and zebra to warthogs and whatever else they can catch. But you see, these warthogs are now starting to move back into the area where they were grazing. They ran away because they saw the cats walking through the grass. They weren't trying to hide themselves. And maybe that's what the lions are hoping, is perhaps they know that warthogs don't have the greatest memory and they forget. Now, Anna Marie, you're wondering if baboons or monkeys are ever included in a lion's menu. Most certainly, it's just not on top of the list. You'll find, though, that something like a leopard will prey more on vervet monkeys and baboons, and that's just because, well, leopards are exceptionally good at climbing trees, and so are baboons and monkeys. So they tend to go for them. There's a leopard by the name of Mashabeni down in the southwestern corner of the Sabi Sand. He's one of the resident males and moves around in Sabi, and he often would catch baboons. You'd hear them going ballistic around Bush Lodge at night, and you'd hear the terrifying screams of the baboons as they tried to escape, but they weren't quick enough, and he'd often catch them and be feeding on them between Bush Lodge and Salati, which is another camp on Sabi. So he was quite good at that. He's actually the leopard I'd say I've seen most when it comes to feeding on baboons, and baboons in particular. Lions, of course, they would. If there was one that was maybe injured and down on the ground and quite easy to catch, they would definitely go for it. But lions will, of course, go for other things. And remember, they live in prides, they live in family groups, so there's normally more than one of them. And one baboon or one vervet monkey wouldn't be a very good meal for too many, well, many more mouths than one. So they prefer to go for something else. But I think we'll stick around with these girls for a little bit longer to see what they get up to. Perhaps that elephant comes through and chases them off their mound. Jamie's staring at some lions across the river.
We are indeed the Paradise Pride lying across the river, doing what I think Manu and I have been doing, which is enjoying the first rays of proper sunlight after a bit of a cloudy start to the morning. I've been sitting here trying to photosynthesize, but unfortunately my chronic genetic lack of chlorophyll makes that very difficult. But it has been a really, really lovely morning spent in the company of the Paradise Pride. Now, a little bit earlier on, they were sitting, looking across the river at some zebra, watching, waiting, commiserating maybe, I don't know. But it is a lovely scene. It looks like most of them have now made their way across the river. The past few days, the pride's sort of been split. And of course, while we sit on the banks of the river, there's all sorts of other things to keep us entertained while the lions are sleeping. The hippopotamus have gathered here, the hippopotamus of the main north crossing, the pod that's always here, visible sometimes out of the water, sometimes looking a little bit like rocks, and sometimes just visible by a stream of bubbles that they leave behind. What are you two up to? I doubt mating. I suspect just resting. Convenient resting place. Because, of course, hippos can't, A, can't doggy paddle, and B, wouldn't want to doggy paddle, so they can't really swim. They tend to rest up where the water is shallow. And sometimes it's just very convenient to lean on somebody else's back. Plop! Under the water. Ah, Trista, while we watch our magnificent Mara River and all those other adjectives, you want to know if I have ever wanted to a safari in the Amazon? And the answer to that is absolutely I have. There are certain places that I really, really want to go and certain animals that I really, really would love to see. I would love to see an anaconda. I don't know why, I just, well, I do know why. I think they're amazing creatures. I would love to see an anaconda, I really want to see a jaguar. I really would love to see, I mean, we're looking at crocodiles, I want to see jaguars hunting caimans. I would like to see an ocelot. I would also like to go on a safari in other places as well. I would really love to see wolves in the wild. I've never seen a wolf in the wild. These are the wolves of the water, I suppose, if you could compare them in that way. Probably a bit of a stretch of the imagination, though. Crocodiles sunning themselves on the banks. Where would you like to go on safari? I want to go on safari to Ethiopia as well. I want to go and see Africa's most endangered predator, the Ethiopian wolf, or the red wolf. They've got quite a few names. But I'm content for now to be on safari in Kenya. I can't really complain, can I? We've got views like this, lions like this, and this particular pride. I don't know if I want to call them predictable, but certainly creatures of habit in this particular spot. Capitalizing on the crossings that go on, first of all during the migration, of course, but all year round as well. The zebras go backwards and forwards from one side to the other, and the lions wait for their exhaustion to make them more vulnerable. This particular pride has got a couple of sub-adult males. There's at least three of them that I've seen. So, of course, voracious appetites. And all that growing that they're doing. Well, he says that he would like to go to the Mara on safari. It is, hands down, I would say, in terms of what you can see out here, and maybe not the ease of seeing it, but the almost guarantee of seeing it. I think it is probably one of the best places one could possibly go on safari. And yes, of course, there is the draw of the migration, whether you go to Tanzania or whether you go to, or you come here to the Mara during the time of the migration. And that is wonderful. It is a far apart from the lions and all of that and the way that they capitalize on it. It is an astounding feeling to see that many animals, but there is a magic draw to this place regardless of the time of year, whether or not the wildebeest are here. And I love a river. I really, really do. I love a river. I could quite happily drive up and down a river the entire time. So sitting watching young hippos play like this, the rush of the water, I always want to be somewhere where there's a river. My favorite drives through Kruger are the ones through along the rivers, the Sand, the Sabi. The Limpopo. A lazy day for the hippos. I came out this way to see if I could find Scar. He's absent. I'm sure he hasn't gone far, but I can't find him. I don't know where he's gone. The unfortunate nature of the territory that they have found is the fact that it is a very high use area, so nobody's allowed to off-road here, which I completely agree with. But it does make finding him a little bit more tricky. Okay, well, our lions snooze their day away on the banks of the river. Let's head back across to Taylor to find out whether they're showing any more interest in the warthogs around them.
We've got a warthog, funny enough, Jamie. I think it's trying to decide where it needs to go. I think it knows that danger is around and it needs to be cautious this morning. But it's looking in the wrong direction. It's staring at us. I'm not going to eat you, warthog. I promise. But there is a network of burrows. You can actually start to see some of the soil spots in between the grass. And around there will be lots and lots of burrows. It's quite interesting how many warthogs actually den together. Sometimes you'll see small family groups, you know, two females and their offspring together. But here, there was a variety of, different families. Lots of females with their little ones. Big boars, quite a few big boars, in fact. And all denning communally. I'd love, if I was small enough, to be able to safely crawl into one of those burrows and try and shimmy my way through and see how deep they go, where they go off to, where the different sleeping sites are. I think that would be really amazing. Now, Max, you're wondering how many piglets in a litter? Typically, you can see anywhere between 4 and 6. Unfortunately, most of them won't make it to adulthood, if any of them. They don't have a great chance of survival, and they fall prey to many different animals, and particularly lions at this time of the year when they are having piglets. Because when lions do chase off after a warthog, a big boar might even deter a lioness on her own if he's big enough, and they do get large here, weighing in almost over 100 kilograms. And for a piglet, it's very easy because they're uncoordinated, they don't know which way to go, they're not quite as quick as the adults, and then they make a mistake and they separate from mom. Although I have seen females trying to put themselves between a predator and her little ones, and sometimes it works, especially with leopards and cheetah. I've seen it a few times where mom has come in and said, no, you will not take one of my piglets, and charged back at a leopard, and I've seen it with cheetah too, and they've just gone running and, you know, heading for the hills. They went, what? No, warthog's off the menu all of a sudden, which I thought was quite cool. It was always nice to see the prey turning around and fighting back and actually ending up and winning. But I don't think these girls are going to do too much. So to be honest, the way that they're sitting, I don't think they're in the mood to catch anything. So I think let me go backwards. Let's carry on for a little bit longer. We'll keep an eye out on them and see what else we can find. There are quite a few elephants moving in the forest today. I think they're preparing for a warm day. Megan, do we know what the temperature is going to be in Kenya? And then also, can I please have that question again? I'm so sorry. It was a bit muffled. I couldn't quite hear it. There's our warthogs. Look. There they are. One's going back in the burrow. Now, Mystic, you've said that warthogs seem to love elephants. You're wondering if it's for protection. I think it's just a coincidence, to be honest. These warthogs are living in this area. The elephants have no designated home. They just constantly keep moving around. So it's more like the elephants passing through areas that the warthogs just happen to be. If anything, they might not be relying on what an elephant has to say. They'll probably listen to the baboons and the topi and the waterbuck and the zebra all alarming. And these lions are on the move again. There they are. So yes, I don't think that it's for protection at all. Absolute lies, Megan, it can't be. Megan's directing. She says it's only 18 degrees Celsius. Never. Real feel is probably about 22. Let's go live, please, if that's possible. I just want to see what happens here. We're going to do an action broadcast, everybody. I'm going to sit quietly now. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. We are staring at a lioness on the move towards some warthog burrows. We are live, and this is happening right now in the Mara Triangle in Kenya, and the beautiful open plains, and it's very, very exciting out here. And for those of you who have just jumped on board, again, a big welcome. And because this is live and interactive, you can have a chat with me right now, and you can do that by just commenting away in the comment section, and they'll be fed to me. But how cool is this? We found these lions on the edge of a forest early this morning, and unfortunately, they had baboons alarming. They had topi shouting out that they were in the area. So all the warthogs, all the waterbuck, all the zebra went racing away, and now they've just sat up quietly on the termite mound, and they're on the move again. And there are two unsuspecting victims that they're looking at. You can see Impala at the back, they're watching the lions, but luckily for these girls, they're not saying anything. And that's the key to, well, I suppose a successful hunt, is that you don't want anyone to know that you're around. Now there's one that's a little bit closer. I don't know if she's, surely she must have seen the warthogs. I thought that's what she was going to go for. Come on, girl, you're going to have to hide yourself if you want any chance at trying to get some breakfast this morning. And you can see they are looking a little bit on the lean side, so they're going to be searching for the next meal. She doesn't seem to be concealing herself right now. Perhaps there's a technique behind this. Maybe she's trying out a different hunting strategy. Lots of African buffalo just scattered at the back. We are in a beautiful marshy area. We aren't allowed to off-road here. I would not off-road here anyways because of the amount of rain we had yesterday. The rivers all started to flow, and areas that weren't rivers became rivers. So we need to just let the ground have a bit of time to, of course, absorb all that water. Now, Patricia, thank you for the first question. You've said, what a beautiful picture. It is indeed. It's lovely. Now, my name is Taylor McCurdy, and on camera with me today is Archie, bringing you all the most amazing, magnificent wildlife. And hopefully we are going to have a little bit of action. But take a look there. The warthogs have spotted the lions now and are actually moving away. I think they're slightly frustrated, these lioness. I don't know if their plans are all going the way they wanted them to go this morning, but that's just life, isn't it? And lions aren't necessarily the most successful hunters out of the big cats. It takes them a couple of attempts before they catch something. Well, it can take them a few attempts. Now she's staring straight across at us. I wonder if she's going to come and investigate around these warthog burrows. Now, Raymond, you're wondering how old I think this lioness is. She's an adult, obviously. I would say she's between about 5 or 6 years old, somewhere around there. The other lioness I thought looked slightly older. She's just coming in from the left now. They're catching up. I think what's going to happen here is I think they're going to investigate around these warthog burrows and see if somebody hasn't quite woken up just yet. I think this girl is a little bit older. I would say she's probably about eight or nine years old. It is very difficult to try and age these animals, though, especially if you haven't watched them from birth. So I'm just looking for signs around their ears to see how tattered they are, if there are any scars. You can see their noses aren't particularly sort of weeks before they go searching or for their den site. You'll see the mammary glands starting to swell. Oh, isn't that precious? Just laying about, having a quick rest. Well, you're not going to catch any warthogs if you do that yet, ladies. How cool is that? What beautiful cats. Let's see. They're still up and moving. Now, this could go two ways. They're either going to investigate around the burrows. Maybe they've seen something around the bend, which I haven't seen. Or are they looking for a shady spot? Now, that face says it all, though. That says to me that I'm not looking for shade. That says I'm looking for breakfast. Christopher, you said maybe they need to use reverse psychology. Perhaps. See, look at those ears pricked forward. Eyes staring straight down the nose. What have you seen around the bend that I haven't seen? Their eyesight is so good, though, that they could have spotted something that I have absolutely no idea that's there. Okay, let's move up a bit closer. I think we need to be able to see what's around this corner. And you can see the lions are completely relaxed with us as well. They're not bothered at all. And that's just because we've been interacting with these cats for such a long time. So many different vehicles driving around in the Masai Mara National Reserve, and as well as the Mara Triangle, where we're driving around at the moment. So they're very much used to the cars, but they don't see us as prey. They'll completely ignore us. Oh, there's the next warthog. So all I'm going to do now is I'm going to pass her, and I'm going to move up just a little bit, and I can see the warthogs just in the distance. This could get quite exciting. There's also some buffalo. Now, another fantastic question from Linda this morning. Thank you for sending them all through. You're wondering, what is the typical lifespan for a lion? So it depends whether they're male or female. The girls tend to live a little bit longer than the boys. It's a very, very tough life for a male lion. And a lioness can live to about 16, 17 years old as a really old girl, but an average lifespan of about 14 years. And a male lion is in his prime from about 6 to about 10 years old. And then after that, they normally, unfortunately, succumb to injuries from a pride takeover from other male lions at around 10 years old. But there have been reports of, and I've seen some older boys living to about 12, 13, but that's really, really old. And he also won't be living with a pride, so life becomes exceptionally tough. So there the warthogs are, moving through the grass. Let me see if I can count how many there are. 1, 2. I'm sure when I drove up I saw a few more. I think there were a couple. There's 3. And I'm sure I had seen a fourth one somewhere, but the grass is quite tall. That's good for the lions. That is very, very good for the lions. Now, Junior, you're wondering if I ever get afraid. Of course I do. Not in the cars, though. I've got a healthy respect for the animals. That's the most important thing. And I know that I'm safe as long as I don't do anything silly. The warthogs, I think, are suspecting something's around. However, when I'm on bushwalk, so in South Africa, we have another camp down there, and we will walk around in a big 5 areas. That can be a little bit intimidating, but a good experience. It's an adrenaline rush like you cannot believe, not knowing what's going to be around the next corner. So in the cars, I'm quite happy, except unless you stumble across a very angry elephant. Sometimes that can send shivers down your spine. But it's important as a guide to not get too complacent around these animals, because that's how accidents happen. And we all do it. We all get too relaxed and too comfortable. So it is important just to remind yourself, it doesn't matter how long you've been working out in the bush, that you need to respect the animals. So they're getting close. She's getting quite close. This other girl's coming up from the rear. She's just passing the car now. Achoo! Excuse me. And if any of you had any doubt that this wasn't live, we would have cut the sneeze out. Sorry about that. Lots and lots of hay fever at this time of year, with all the grass and flowers out and about. Now, those warthogs are moving away. I don't know if they've seen her just yet. They don't have the greatest eyesight, but they do have a very good sense of smell, and their hearing is not too shabby either. But I also feel like these girls are not really putting in too much effort this morning. Now, Shane, you're wondering if the lions would prefer buffalo or warthog. Well, Shane, they love either. They even love that zebra that you can see at the back. They would love to catch one of those. So for these two lionesses, a warthog would be a perfect meal. They'd be able to gobble it up and probably only finish it later this evening, maybe even the early hours of tomorrow morning. If it was a big pride alliance, they would need something bigger like a buffalo to keep them going. I mean, that creature over there weighs almost, well, he's spotted the lions. You can see a big buffalo bull. There's also a tractor with a hot air balloon. That's what you can see going back to camp now. It's been dismantled. And that buffalo, though, is a bit too big for these lionesses. The buffalo up here in the Mara get much bigger than those in South Africa. There's just so much food around for them to eat. It's almost never-ending buffet. And they give the lions a run for the money all the time. I've actually seen more buffalo chasing lions up here than I have seen lions feasting on buffalo. But these cats are moving very, very far away from us now, and unfortunately I cannot off-road, and it doesn't look like they're going for the warthogs anymore. They've actually moved well away. They're ahead of the warthogs. I think she's heading to a spot where she can find some shade. But what I will do is I'll try and get around and follow these cats, and hopefully they'll get up to something exciting a little bit later. But for myself and Archie, I hope you enjoyed that, and remember to keep an eye out for those live notifications. Wasn't that amazing? I'm a bit sad about these lions, though. I thought they really were going to catch those warthog, but anyways, they've walked right past them. There's still one girl here sitting in the shade, but I think she's going to follow that other lioness. I think they're getting ready to settle down for the day. Baboons are also starting to alarm, so they're going to have to wait for everything to settle before they make another attempt. So we're going to go off and find some other animals to look at. Let's go back to Jamie and see if she's blowing any bubbles. I don't know why she would be blowing bubbles. Maybe she has one of those things that you blow bubbles with. Let's go and see.
I'm feeling in one of those, I don't know, strange, what's the word? Strange moods. Let's go with that. So I'm looking for Scar and I can't find him. I've checked under every single one of his favorite gardenias except for this row. And of course, he doesn't always sleep under the same trees, but he usually does. If he's on this side, he's usually around here somewhere. I'm hoping maybe we get lucky. And that, he's somewhere resting here. There's a crowned crane. There's two crowned cranes and some, hold on, some very alert looking topi. It's stopping binoculars and just see what that topi's looking at. Give me one sec. Of course, for us, oh, it's not that alert looking. For us, it is second nature to lift our binoculars, but I always forget that I've got a microphone in my hat. So if it makes horrible ruffling sounds, I'm really sorry. It's because I keep hitting it with my binoculars every time I use them. Something that we are unaccustomed to. There we go, some really pretty crowned cranes. It's amazing. When I first arrived here, you did not see a crowned crane on this side of the river, and all of a sudden they're here. With all of the rain that we've had, the amount of water that's around, it just seems to have attracted them in, if not great numbers, certainly more than they were when I first started here. And I've been here for 6 months or so, nearly. Definitely one of my favorite birds of the Mara. I don't think I'll ever get tired of looking at them. Like, I don't know, there's some kind of... It's like a really artistic child drew a picture of a bird. Do you know what I mean? Does that make any sense? Manu, do you know what I mean? You know exactly what I mean. I'm so glad. It's so outside of the norm. You know, and the little red wattle and then the crest on the top of the head. It is like a really artistic child created a fantasy bird. Or an artistic adult, I suppose. It doesn't have to be a child. Some kid with a box of crayons. And it became real. I don't know if that makes any sense, but it does in my head. November, Mom? No, I have not. And it's actually something that we've spoken about a few times recently. The possibility of seeing crowned crane chicks. Now, if I remember correctly, I believe I looked this up the last time. I think their breeding season is now. So we should, at some point, get lucky. You'd think we would. I mean, there's so many around here. It seems almost impossible that we aren't going to see one. I know that we've also spoken about it in terms of ostriches and seeing ostrich chicks, and I know Brent found that nest on the other side of the river, so that was one thing we spoke about checking. But no, I have not seen a crowned crane chick, nor have I seen an immature crowned crane. So one that hasn't quite reached the dramatic extremes of the adult plumage. But it's on my list of things I would like to find for you, I promise. I'm always looking. And I mean, we know where there's a couple of breeding pairs. We're familiar with them. We see them all the time in this area. We've got to get lucky at some point, surely. See a crowned crane chick? Okay. I am going to try and find Scar. I'm sure he's got to be here somewhere. So while we do that, I'm going to send you across to Taylor, whose warthogs apparently are overjoyed at their survival.
Jamie, if you find Scar, you have to promise me that you're going to do a hair flick this morning. What was that? I think it was an elephant. Now, this warthog boar is chasing around a group of warthogs. I'm not quite sure what's going on. I wonder if there aren't a few young boars that are about a year old or so now, and they're still hanging around with Mum or in the vicinity, and he's basically saying get lost. Or he's excited by some females. I haven't quite decided as to what's going on because it's quite far away from us, but he is persistent, which is good news for our lioness who has popped out. And she's actually popped out here just to the right of my car, and she's staring at them. She's just over there, which is quite cool. It is actually quite eerie. As we came around the corner, she was just standing with sort of shrubs surrounding her, and she was staring out. And you can see she's focused on them. And this might sort of help her out this morning if that big warthog boar is too focused on chasing around the other warthogs. Is going to make a move. But I don't think, let's not get too excited just yet, because she's quite far away. She's still got a lot of ground cover, and we know with lion hunts, sometimes they can happen in 2 seconds, sometimes they can take 3 hours or 2 days. Well, not quite 2 days, they would have given up by then, but you get my point. But she's staring, she's looking around. I don't think she wants to put too much effort in this morning, because she's had some chances to catch warthogs. It just means that she would have actually had to do some work and stalk and get low and work those muscles. Maybe she just doesn't want to. And the other lioness, I don't even know where she is. I think she's still down at the back hiding under some shrubs. But here she comes again. See, look how that posture changes. That's one of my favorite things, is the way they arch their back and they lower their heads. That looks a little bit more like what we want to see. But she's fooled us twice now. We will not be fooled a third time. You can hear the baboons as well in the distance. Now, Farah, you've said that she is such a beautiful creature. She is indeed. Lionesses are stunning girls, although the musketeer lions are pretty spectacular as well for male lions. They're also beautiful. But she is nice. She is a lovely girl. No, don't sit down. No, she's going to take a rest. And then you can see that's why these hunts can go on and on and on and on, is because they'll stop, they'll rest like she's doing now, and they've already done this twice before, before she reached this point, sorry. You're making me anxious. What are you going to do, lion? This is the hardest part. Now, Matthew, wondering what is the apex predator in Africa? I'm going to have to go and say the Nile crocodile is most certainly the apex predator. They don't mind what they eat. They eat everything and anything. They will eat a lion. They will eat a baby elephant if they can catch one that's crossing the river. They will go for anything. They will go for humans. They're one of the few animals out there that actively consistently hunt people. So you want to be careful of them. Especially down on the Mara River. If you were watching earlier, Jamie did show you some crocodiles, and I don't know if they were swimming or just resting up on the banks. So yeah, they're the apex. And then, of course, and you'll have the rest of the cats. You'll have the lion, you'll have leopard and hyena, or going all the way down. Well, not that a hyena is a cat. I'm just looking around. Let's go have a look at the elephants, because I feel like she's just going to sit here for a while. We'll come back. We won't go too far. There's just some ellies up ahead. Yeah, she's just rolled over. Typical. And and there's giraffe. There's lots of animals around here today. This is actually a very nice spot. You know, the marsh can be amazing. It's a bit of a gamble though, because it's quite far out of the way and there's not many roads. You know, it's sort of, there's a road that hugs along the tree line and then there's one that cuts the marsh in half. It's a massive area. And some days it's just empty and you'll have a couple of birds. But on mornings like today, you win and you get lions, you get elephants, you get banded mongoose, giraffe, warthogs, waterbuck, zebra. I mean, the list is honestly endless. The things that I'm probably not even seeing will be around. We won't stay here for long because I have seen this girl already and she wasn't happy earlier. Hello, Matthew, who is a new viewer. You've said that you have only just started watching, but you already love it. That's really great to hear. So, Matthew, now I would like a question from you. So hashtag safariLIVE, or if you're chatting to us on the YouTube chat, you can just put a question in there. And here we go. Let's get your first question answered. Maybe, have you ever been on a safari before? Tell us more. Let us know. Okay, so the reason why I say that I've seen this girl and I know that she wasn't particularly happy. I'm just going to stop here. It's okay. She's fine. But you can see she's secreting from her temporal glands. Remember this morning we were talking about how do you identify an elephant bull that's in must, and I was telling you about the temporal gland, and I said it was a pity that they weren't secreting at the time. Now, I don't know, this cow is not very happy. Well, she's now going to use the luxury facilities. That's the typical stance. The James Hendry stance, because he just gets all the animals using the facilities at all times. Isn't that wonderful? That's quite nice. Multitasking at its best. Sometimes they'll even eat while they do this too. It's very impressive. And she is slightly stressed. She doesn't look heavily pregnant. Her mammary glands are not swollen. So I actually don't know if she's pregnant at all. I wonder why she doesn't seem so happy. And she was trumpeting. She was making some strange sounds earlier when we first spotted the lions on the other side of the tree line. So we will give her a little bit of room. She's a big cow. She's not young either. She's an older girl. It's okay. Oh, maybe she's just not feeling well. Maybe somebody has said something to her that perhaps her hair doesn't look as great as what it normally does. You know, these things can knock one's confidence. And something is now biting her. You can see she's trying to scratch with her leg. I mean, in between the folds of skin. She's just munching away. And she's settling down. She still just doesn't look happy. The way that she's holding her ears away from her body, the fact that her tail is stretched out away from her body. Oh, no, now I know why. No, there we go. Yeah, I wonder if she hasn't got a little bit of an upset stomach. Her stool seems to be intact, though. But this morning I've actually been seeing a couple of elephants that had very upset stomachs. So I wonder what they're eating that's maybe not agreeing with their system. I mean, typically it is supposed to be hard. She still looks alright, though. She's something about her. I get this vibe that she's a little bit unhappy. Alarmo, you're wondering if she's maybe an estrus, perhaps? That's exactly it. Maybe she's a little bit stressed out because the hormones are running wild at the moment. And it's interesting, she's not singing her estrus song. So it's always quite amazing to see that. I mean, I've only seen elephants mating a handful of times. But yeah, maybe she could be an estrus. There's definitely something about her that she's not too happy. But she'll survive. Animals are so tough. They're much more resistant to things than we as humans are. But isn't that good? That's a very good way to tell that this is an elephant cow. We obviously always talk about their heads being quite rectangular, and I think that this girl portrays it very well, and also the angle that we're at the moment shows it off, whereas the male's heads are nice and round, just because we have got a couple of new viewers jumping on board. So there we go, Matthew. Now you know how to tell the difference between a male and a female elephant. Is their heads is the easiest, but you can also use the swollen mammary glands between the front legs for the girls, and then of course, well, yes, you can guess the other way to tell the difference between a male and female. That's quite obvious. Okay, let's go back towards that lion. I just don't want to get too far away from her because I can't see her anymore. I did say we're just going to very quickly pop past the elephants. Let's go back. Hopefully she hasn't... I don't think she's actually moved, but I can see her ears now. So we're going to go and find out if the other lioness has made her way back to the spot over here. Jamie's on a bit of a bumble. I'm not sure what she's looking for next. Maybe Scar will show up.
Well, I'm bumbling looking for Scar, but that doesn't mean I can't stop and have a look at other things, especially since we started our morning with the tiny topi that was all alone. Now we've got a tiny topi that is not all alone and is in fact on a termite mound. Tiny topi on a termite mound. With Mum, which is even better. Tiny topi enjoying the topography of a termite mound? How's that for a vocal warm-up before our TV show on the 14th? Tiny topi tops termite. Oh, I don't know. You work it out for me. Hashtag safariLIVE on Twitter. I give up. It's nice to see the little topi safely protected now. This is the herd that we always see around here. I agree. Megs has pointed out that she loves just how different the colouring is between the topi and the mum. I suppose if Viam were here, he'd be telling us just how the baby topis always forget to put their pyjamas on, just as he did with the Coke's heart beers that is lighter in colour. He said they forgot to put their pants on. I love it. It's interesting because that tawny colour of the topi calves, you see it in so many different antelope. I suppose it's not difficult to see why. It's a better type of camouflage for them. But whether it is roan, baby roan antelope, baby sable antelope, baby oryx or gemsbok, baby... What was I thinking? Oh, even wildebeest. Baby wildebeest are an almost tawny colour. They're almost lion-coloured. It's interesting that of all of the different shapes and sizes that those antelope come in, the larger antelope have these tawny coloured. This morning I said it was a baby topi, but there was a part of me that was wondering if it wasn't a baby hartebeest. It looks so, so similar. It definitely wasn't. It was definitely a baby topi. But there is that moment of doubt. And the topi and the hartebeest, the topi in particular, I mean, to carry on our conversation of animals drawn by children, reminds me of if a child drew a picture between a goat and an antelope. That's sort of what topi remind me of. Oh, we're having a little game. Oh! Upset crowned cranes, ruffled feathers. Topi bouncing about. Running for the sake of running. Poor little one just has to get caught in the middle. It's that tireless bounce of theirs. Oh! The indignity, ruffians. Things just aren't what they used to be. It's the youth of today, you know. All this gallivanting. Millennials just can't be helped. Far too much energy going on here with the topi herd. And they really do. They have this boundless stamina and exceptional running speed. The fastest of the antelope, although all of the hartebeest family are built for speed and stamina. Wildebeest are very closely, I keep calling them family, it's a correct term is tribe. Wildebeest, relatively closely related also. Exceptional stamina, Coke's hartebeest, Sesebi in southern Africa. Now look at this guy, what is the guy on the left even doing? He's just having the best time. Oh. Baby's caught up in it again. Why are we running? Must I run? Okay, I will run. I'll run. Let me run. Look. Spikey, you say, is it correct that they have really poor eyesight? Their eyesight actually is pretty good. It is very much geared towards spotting movement and things trying to be stealthy. So if you watch a topi, they stand on the termite mound, hence the nickname, a nickname I try and avoid as much as I try and avoid calling Impala the McDonald's of the bush. But they're known as the policemen of the Mara because they stand up on termite mounds and they watch, and they're most likely to spot something like a lion, a leopard, or a cheetah. Now, their eyesight is... obviously, they don't see the same level of detail we see. They don't see the same variety of colors that we see. But they are very geared towards spotting movement. I mean, you always read in books that impala are very, very... don't see very well. I dare you to try and sneak up on a herd of impala. It's impossible. Yes, of course, they listen and they smell as well, which does help. But it is a very difficult thing to do. They're geared instinctively. So many years worth of a survival instinct packed into one body. Looking for something. Ah, there's an interesting question from M. Ruth, while our topi harass the crowned crane some more. Now, M. Ruth wanting to know about why they bounce their heads when they walk or when they run. I think that the bounce when they run quite possibly has to do with just the way that their bodies are structured. But something I noticed particularly with this group, and this is a very moist area that they live in, that there's a lot of head nodding. Now, there you go, you see that little head shake. Oh, you're scared of a crowned crane. You are so scared of a crowned crane. I saw that. We all saw that. That was caught on camera. I bet you're embarrassed now, Toby. The reason they nod their heads like that, I suspect, is very similar to what you see in zebra in South Africa. There's bot flies that lay their eggs in the sinus cavities or around the nostrils of the animals like topi or zebra. And the larvae, or the maggots, essentially, it's actually quite a gross thing to think about, but essentially that's got to do with botfly larvae. And typically the animal is able to, I wouldn't say it's a healthy balance, but it doesn't cause them any major harm, it's just discomforting. And I suspect that is the same, what we see in zebra is the same thing that happens here. And if you watch, with the calves especially, they look... it's not just them nodding their heads, they look as though their eyes are quite watery. And I'm sure, because of course your sinus cavity, or their sinus cavities and their tear ducts and so on, all of that would be inflamed. And I'm sure that's why. I don't know with 100% certainty, but I'm pretty sure that's where the head bob comes from. It's the discomfort of the maggots up the nose. It can, in really serious cases, cause blindness. We had a female buffalo on Djuma last year that kept charging cars because she was blind from botfly infestation. And she couldn't see, so it made her feel very frightened and very vulnerable. And so she kept charging people every time they drove past her. I suspect that's what it is. That's where the head bob comes from. I'll double check for you. I'm sure there's a way to find out. Okay, topis have calmed down. Let's go and have a look at the poor ruffled crowned cranes after all that. See how they're feeling. I wonder if they're talking about how this area's just not what it used to be. Okay, we're going to continue on along our journey, still searching for Scar. Let's go across to Taylor, who's had more luck with lions, and she's got a lovely lioness.
You know, Jamie, I just wish Brent was here today on drive so that he could see that I can actually find lions every now and then. He's forever giving me so much grief. And the other day we actually joked and said we're going to change my name to Taylor Can't Find Cats McCurdy. So that's my new name now. Just sometimes I get lucky. It's quite funny. Our lioness is ruining it for herself today in terms of hunting. I'm a bit disappointed in her, if I must be honest, because I love lions. I have not seen a lion hunt for a long time. It's not necessarily that I like the part where they actually catch the animal. I like the build-up, the suspense, all the hard work that goes into a hunt, how coordinated they are when there's more than one lion hunting. The fact that they have to creep. Imagine having to tense your muscles up for long periods of time, especially with the short grass. I think it's really magnificent, and there's a lot of technique and concentration involved in a hunt. It really isn't easy. So the fact that she just is always up and walking around, not trying to conceal herself at all, and what, hoping that dinner is just going to run towards her, is, I think, a little bit cheeky. And she's making me sad today. But maybe she's just building up for this afternoon. Perhaps I'll get lucky this afternoon with this lovely lioness. I'm going to try and come back here and focus on them and see if we can get them successfully taking something down. But I think now that it's warming up, maybe she'll just go back to the tree line and rest up. That's where the other lioness is. She did make her way this side. She's behind the car at the moment, though, just laying in the shrubs, not particularly interested in anything that's going on down here. But the impala also spotted this lioness, and a little while ago they were snorting, telling everybody around here that there's lions. So all the warthogs have vacated. Everyone's moved to the opposite side of the tree line now. No one is hanging around here, and I don't blame them at all. So I think in that case, what we're going to do is we might actually move on. But you know what I do need to do is I need to, let me put a GPS pin here. Let me do that very quickly so you can just watch me do that. I have to turn my location on because I want to know their exact spot as to where they're going to be. Who am I going to send it to? Who's going to be the lucky person? Shall we send it to Jamie? Right. Send it to Jamie. Jamie's just going to get my location now. She's probably going to go, is Taylor stuck? So one last question before we leave these cats, and it's from Amanda, and you're wondering if I've ever seen a lioness take care of another's cubs. Well, in a pride of lions, when you've got many different females living together, they do allo suckle. So one lioness, of course, is going to show preference to her own cubs, but she will suckle the other cubs too. But I think with what you're talking about is, have I seen a lioness adopt, say, a lioness that has lost her cubs? I have not seen that before, but I'm pretty sure it happens. I don't think that it is something that would be too uncommon, especially if it was maybe a lioness from the same pride. I don't necessarily think, well, again, I don't know. There's so much strange things, so many strange things that happen out here in nature, well, that we think is strange, that, you know, an animal would not think is strange. But I'm trying to think if I've ever heard of, maybe Jamie will know too, of a lioness stumbling across cubs and then just taking them for her own. I don't know if that's happened, but also the amount of time we actually spend out in the bush is very little, and we don't really see everything that's going on. I mean, we're still seeing new animal behaviors just popping up, and, you know, with all the amount of time we're spending out at night in areas that no one else has spent nights out before, so it's pretty cool. So what I'm going to do now is, I think, wait, was I supposed to send everyone to Jamie? I've forgotten, Megan. I've got what you told me, the goldfish memory is just kicked in. Like, you have no idea. You didn't. Okay. No, that's fine. I wasn't sure what Megan had said to me. And then I sometimes make up things. Or sometimes I think I like to hear certain things, and then I just pretend like someone said them to me. Let me show you this other lioness very quickly. But I know there's a hole behind me, so I have to do a 17,000 point turn, because I don't want to get too close to this other girl. Oh, she's moving. Oh, hallelujah. Welcome. Welcome to the party. Thank you for joining us this morning. There's the other girl. She's just poking her head out now, which is quite nice, actually. But again, not making any effort to conceal themselves right now, although standing against a tree line like that, they blend in fairly well. No, she's going to enjoy the shade. Okay, we'll leave these girls, and I'm going to come back here a little bit later. Jamie is bumbling about at the moment. I think she is still looking for Scar. Maybe if she does that hair flick, she'll find him sooner.
I'll try and do the hair flick, but, you know, I'm not sure I could ever do it quite as well as Miss McCurdy can, or indeed as well as Scar can with his floppy mop of hair. Though we haven't found Scar, but we have found an adorable baby elephant. A particularly, in my mind, quite a long-limbed baby elephant. I don't know why, it just looks like it's got really long legs. Looks like a little male, moving along behind the rest of the herd. Too sweet with your little trunk. Dare I say, all the better for blowing bubbles with. Sky, it's an interesting thing. We often talk about elephants' poor digestive systems, but it's not really poor. So Sky's question is, why would they have evolved to have poor GIT tracts? What is the advantage? It's not really about it being poor. It's just about it being different. We talk about it being inefficient because essentially an elephant will defecate out about half of what it is they've consumed. So essentially, for a big elephant, it will mean if they eat about 300 kilograms, they will defecate, 150 kilograms of dung. An elephant is a hind gut fermenter. A huge amount of digestion takes place in the intestines. It doesn't ruminate like other animals. So, essentially, the difference, there are advantages and disadvantages to both of them. A ruminant will need to eat about half of what a hindgut fermenter eats of an equivalent weight. So a wildebeest needs to eat about half of what a zebra needs to eat for that reason. But, on the other hand, a hindgut fermenter can consume, when there's large amounts of food, they don't need to worry about being picky, they don't need to worry about settling to ruminate, they can just eat and eat, essentially. And I think if I remember correctly, if I go back to learning about hindgut and ruminators, if I remember correctly, there's also an advantage in terms of protein absorption. But essentially, let's say the food is really low quality. The animal can just consume small amounts of it, or big amounts of it in the case of an elephant, all day long, and process it and get what they can out of it, and not waste too much time trying to get quality where there isn't going to be quality. So let's say that it's a really, really low quality type of food. They can eat lots of it and not waste too much time in terms of digesting it. Right, Taylor and I are on a roll. Lions, lions, now elephants, elephants. Off you go.
We've got an entire line of elephants, Jamie. Let me count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 elephants. All walking in a straight line. How beautiful is that? One even resting its trunk up on a younger sibling. Hello, guys. And look at that tiny tot amongst as the rest. Oh, hello. Someone's found a little bit of water. Nope, not staying for too long, are we? I don't even think you got a little sip in there. Now, they're just going behind the car at the moment. How cool is this? They're so relaxed. We've had the most amazing day with elephants. And any day with any elephants is a good day, in my opinion. And I think Jamie agrees with me. Now, a couple of them have fallen out of formation. How dare you, elephants? This is not how we walk in a straight line. You get 0 out of 10 for your efforts. Or that old girl. We've seen this girl before, actually, a couple of times. Very easy to identify with her tusk, how it goes underneath her trunk. We've seen her, a few times. Older girl, old bird. She's beautiful, though. Everyone's marching to the far. Listen. Now, they've just stopped, but there were some elephants that were trumpeting, and there's so many in the forest at the moment. They're all gone down to the river's edge, but now they've gone quiet. Hello, big girl. She's an incredible elephant. Hello, girl. Are you gonna just walk past us? She's heavily pregnant. Look at that big bulge. Her mammary glands are also very swollen. She's walking. Hello, girl. She's walking right past the car. I'm just watching her. She's fine. She's very relaxed with us. With these naughty ones over here. Oh, that was so cool. She walked past us so closely and didn't even flinch. I flinched. Now, these young boys hanging at the back, well, one boy and one girl, hanging at the back of the herd, they've decided that they don't need the adults anymore. They're quite all right all on their own. Well, this must be about the fourth or fifth herd I've seen marching straight towards the river's edge, towards the forest. She goes cheekily stomping off, shaking her head. Who are you showing off for, young lady? Catching up to the rest of the group. Now, the socially awkward girl, you're wondering if it's true that little elephants will hold on to the bigger one's tail so they don't get lost. I've only ever seen it twice. Can you believe that? I'm going to keep driving as I answer this, not because they've disappeared. So I've seen it twice where a little elephant is actually held onto an adult's tail. And once was going through a long grass, and then the other time was they were just, I don't know, walking on short grass. There's nothing in particular. So yes, they can most certainly do so. But I you don't actually see it as often as you'd like because it's quite sweet. The most amazing thing though is watching little elephants try and cross a river with the help of the adults. They definitely need the help of the adults as we are we gonna make it. No, we're trapped in here. Oh, that was deep. Goodness, there goes my camera. Whoops, sorry camera. When the adults will actually put their trunks underneath the little ones and support them. Obviously they're not tall enough to be able to touch the bottom and just use their trunks as a snorkel. So they'll use their little trunks as a snorkel and the adults will actually help move them around. And they stand nice and close to them, especially if there's a strong current, just to help with that. So that's really amazing to see. Ooh, another question. And another one from the socially awkward girl. You're wondering how much do the elephants usually weigh? So elephants, I mean, a big bull can weigh 5.5 tons, exceptionally up to six tons, but that's a big elephant bull. And cows can weigh anywhere between 3.5 and 4.5 tons. So they're not small. I'm left, so I'm, oh my gosh, 90 seconds. Now we're gonna test the brakes. I don't really have any here. Okay, we'll switch off and then hopefully we'll stop. But there's another smaller group of elephants. Maybe they're a part of that big herd we just saw walk past. This could be a satellite party. You wouldn't want to get in between this group and the group we've just seen on foot. That's when you get yourself into a bit of trouble. So they're trying to catch up. But everybody is on their way to the Mara River this morning. I wonder what's going down. Perhaps there's a pool party planned. I don't know. Maybe it's someone's birthday and they're going to celebrate. I thought I did see a elephant walking around with a balloon in its trunk. No, I'm only just joking. That's absolute nonsense. I didn't see that. That would be quite cool to see, though. Hey, what a lovely day. But the clouds have come back over. It's now all overcast, which is not so great. Now, it has been a spectacular day. I think we've all seen a variety of different animals out in the bush, from lions, male lions, female lions, elephants, all sorts of creatures, wild dog, how exciting, with Noel, hyena, you name it. Love those days. But let's have one last look at these elephants as they march towards the Mara River. Isn't this stunning? Ha. Now, unfortunately, that's all the time we've got for you, so thank you so much for joining into the Sunrise Safari. Remember, it's a private rehearsal this afternoon. Cheerio.